On this week's episode of Just a Walk, Thanks, a deep dive into P. Diddy, a bit of Trump gear, a bit of Kamala Harris gear. Just Rob just sort of takes us through from his point of view everything that's going on over there in America. We look at the AFL, Sam Mitchell's petulance and Hawthorn's just sort of falling in a heap there over in Adelaide. We deep dive into this weekend's AFL Grand Final. We give you a tip and a Norm Smith medalist. We look at the Manicato and the Golden Rose, two enormous races. One's Friday night, Grand Final Eve. One's on the Saturday in Moonee Valley and at Rose Hill. Plus, Butch recaps what's happened at the recent initial first two-year-old jump outs in Sydney. Hope you enjoy the show. G'day punters, welcome to episode 12, maybe, of Just a Walk, Thanks. Present at today's meeting, Rob Scurry, whose lungs are greener than Snoop Dogg's right now. Mickey Gannon, live from his bedroom. It's 1 p.m. as we record. Jay Rayner, fresh off another winner for Marlborough Buzzsock up there in Ipswich, which he nailed the first four in order. And as always, the mayor of Seymour, the swinging king, Butch Bourne. Butch, how are you?
Now's as good a time as any, Dicko, to announce my retirement from horse training.
Wow. You weren't going to keep it for ESPN too?
Listen, I don't know. I didn't really want to clash with any discussions with P. Diddy, but I thought, you know, the time's right. And of course, the five people that listen, they'll be it's going to be big news for them.
Didn't have anything to do with Wanjiru, did it, Butch?
What do you reckon? I was pushed.
Well, I reckon it was one of the old school, great setups from a veteran of the turf, 17s into 12s late. Laura Lafferty did the steering, a senior rider went on, which was what you believed. Was the cause of the improvement for the horse to get the job done there. One of the great setups all time. Full credit to you. How'd that go?
Oh, I felt like I had black hair, Dicko. Seriously. It was just like, it was just from back in the day. It was like winding the clock back. It's going to be probably the thing I miss, to be honest, that sort of thing. But yes, Dicko, yeah, go ahead.
Wanjiru held up for clear running from the 400 until passing the 200 metres. When questioned in regards to the seemingly improved performance, trainer David Bourne explained that the gelding was suited to the greater distance than that of its most recent start and took benefit from having a senior jockey engaged.
Some horses just don't go for apprentices, and, you know, that's pretty much what all it was, to be honest. And, you know, yeah, just a few little tweaks, you know.
Little tweaks, yeah, a little bit.
The old hypergate chamber bullshit.
This happened on the 10th of September, which was my birthday. I speak to Butch more than I speak to any human being on earth now. I speak to him every single day. And I, like you guys listening to this, I was also left out of this.
No, I think you're probably putting a bit of mayo on that. No. I think you rejected three of my phone calls, that's what you're probably more upset with yourself about. And that, or the other thing that probably upsets you is that your fact that you're in your 30s and you're still wearing a footy jumper.
Well, unlike yourself and Rob, Rob's had two teams. My team's still playing football, and they're playing on Saturday. So we're definitely going to go run through the entirety of the AFL Grand Final at some point on today's show. And when we do that, we will back over some of the petulance that the Hawthorn Football Club showed when they got rolled by Ken and the boys over there in Adelaide. Should we start there, Rob? What was your takeaways from Sam Mitchell's behaviour, narrative, language, old man versus a young man? Some hot takes there from Sam.
Yeah, look, I'm not interested in football journalism or, you know, dissecting. I enjoy watching the game, but the media side of it and that sort of thing has no interest for me. More interested in the racketeering and sex trafficking case of Mr. Sean Puffy Combs.
Which we'll get to later on. I thought it's a great narrative and just a great story of personal growth for Sam Mitchell, who was it 5 or 10 years ago was parading around the MCG, insinuating needles into his arms as he was playing against Essendon, which, you know, some could say was bad taste, some could say was entertaining. He's really gone the full. He's really turned the corner, hasn't he, Butch?
Yeah, I think this is just a storm in a teacup, really. I mean, you know, I was a bit surprised that, you know, that they were chucking grenades pre-match, and then when, you know, Kenny launched one post-match, that they all jumped up and down and screamed. I mean, even the fact that he got fined, you know, 20,000 or something. It's like, you know, if you were fair dinkum about bringing the game into disrepute or the way it looks, wouldn't you wind it back a bit to the original tweets and those sort of things that or Instagram or whatever the bloody hell they used? Because it's either happening or it's not happening. If it's happening and it shouldn't happen, then prosecute everybody. So I just think it was got to remember Ken Hinckley. Like I can't even get my head around what sort of pressure he would be under. He gets booed by his own bloody club, for Christ's sake, all his supporters. He must have so much emotion built up inside him. I mean, I could just put myself in that situation. I don't think I would have been buzzing around like a bee with my arms up, you know, going, oh, you're not flying, Jack. You know, I probably would have ramped that one up a bit more too.
Yeah, me too.
I think I would have taken out Sicily so that, you know, Luke Bruce hit the deck or something, you know, getting chaired off. I would have gone next level.
Boy.
I think it was ridiculous. I think it was just absolutely ridiculous. So if they're going to let the players like Jack Ginnivan, you know, chuck grenades, then someone's entitled to chuck them back. So, yeah, I didn't. And then, that's of course, fair. Yeah, go, Rob.
Fair. That's fair enough. Yeah, Jack started it, and he's, you know, I was probably one of my least favourite players in the league, and now he's one of my favourite. Yeah, well, not one of my favourites. Got to love the Wiz more, but I'm glad it's a Hawthorn. You know, he's a good player.
I think your little charmed run will be a little bit different next start, you know. All of a sudden, you know, you're jumping from barrier 7, everyone's going, oh, this horse can have the PR because it can't win. Next year, you'll be 3 wide, no cover. It'll be a lot tougher. And, I can't wait.
No.
Wild the pokies.
It's a great conversation to have. Would you rather get knocked out early in the finals or lose a grand final? Like, it's a... I don't know, you know, it should be losing.
Lose a grand final every day of the week. Not even close.
Yeah. 100% too, because if you're Hawthorn, you get to play in a prelim up in Sydney. You would have got spanked, but you're a young group and you learn a lot and your experience has grown significantly for the next season.
Which is why the Swans will win for their damaging, was it Geelong defeat? They'll learn a lot.
And it's a dark day.
And you, in most of these elite level sports, you need to lose one before you win one, and they're in a very, very good position.
Very young list too.
The Swans have taken that to the next level. They've lost the last 3 or 4, haven't they?
They've lost the last 3. They lost, I believe, maybe the last time Hawthorn played in the grand final, they lost to Hawthorn. We lost to the Bulldogs, Rob's second team. And his first team when Hawthorn aren't going any good. We lost to them in 2016 with the biggest disparity in free kick count in the history of an AFL grand final, which is more than over 100 years of history. And then we were disgraceful against the Cats, and our redemption comes Saturday afternoon at the MCG.
How many of those players, though, like, it was obviously coming through that Cats game, Jack, and then line up this week? Obviously, they probably wouldn't have been there. Many of them would have been there once prior.
There's a fair few, but like there's two All Australians that have got another 80 games or 60 games under their belt and are in elite form. I don't know what Chris Fagan's going to do. Is he going to tag everyone? What would you do, Butch? Are you going to tag Errol, Heaney, Warner?
No, I just back blokes like Eric Hipwood to get the job done. And, I think that's what you do. You just go head to head. But
Butch, you declared the Swannies against the Lions up there, and our man perhaps got injured, and that was it. And we've had a fortune on him, so it's still you got to pay for dinner for that.
Well, in Butch's defence, that's probably the match of the year, and the Swans just got done,
and they were going to win.
And Papley mid game, and Haywood was running around on one leg. So
and now it sounds like you're off him. What's going on?
No, he's trying to do now as a cranky old man with his football team. Into irrelevance, half of them in Europe, the rest of them in rehab for injury recovery.
Any joined you in your retirement?
Just Butch? Throw some shade and make me a little bit half as grey as he is.
Now but let's address the elephant in the room, right? Which is
left.
Besides the adult with the footy jumper on, the
podcast. What is
Gano? Yeah. Surely, yeah, okay.
That's a compliment. Thank you.
They've been going around Moonee Valley over 1,000 meters. Okay, now they're at Flemington, straight six, Group One, exposed, nowhere to hide. Right, there are little tight turns at Moonee Valley. Right, SCG, MCG.
Yeah, and
well, there's nowhere to hide, mate.
How many games the Lions played at the MCG this year?
Do you know the answer?
Be a bit bloody cold for them, I tell you. They won't know what's going on down there. That'll be a bit of frostbite.
Give me some thoughts on the key matchups, Butch, and the game. What's going to happen? Why?
The age-old question when you play the Swans. Is it Goulden? Is it the Lizard? Is it Warner? Is it Heaney? Who do you go to? So they're going to have to, designate their cooler to one of those guys, but all the same, you still got to play your own. You got to win the game. So I think if they can widen the ground and use every bit of it, then that'll help them a long way. But don't discount the fact that they're replacing Oscar McInerney with someone that none of us have ever heard of. So. You know, that's probably going to be the killer. That would be the killer. The Swan. What price are the Swans at the moment?
$1.77.
Yeah, I thought $1.40. We spoke last week, and I just thought $1.40 was a gift against Port Adelaide. But if they could get $1.80 the Swans, it'd be every day of the week, I reckon.
I think that the Lions have been poor last 2 weeks and have had to play absolute chaos, risk football and got away with it. They were allowed to do it against the Giants through poor structure and dumb tactical nous from the Giants that got them back into it. Geelong looked tired and slow last week when they got out twice. They got the second connection to an outlet. There was just no chase from Geelong. The intent's going to be very, very different on Saturday. Swans are fresh. They tackled like ferociously against Port Adelaide and they were clean and they were sharp. And if I was a betting man, which I don't need to bet on this because there's enough on it, the wider spaces and the good weather predicted for Saturday and at the MCG will suit Sydney. They played like risk-free sort of out of defence at the SCG. They can do it more so at the MCG. I think they'll tag Heaney, and I think he's the one that you sort of don't need to tag. You just got to run with a little bit because he'll beat you anyway. Whereas you could potentially stop Chad or you could potentially stop Goulden a little bit. I think it sets up enormous. Grundy's just got to go with him, and if they stay with him, he just gets better the longer a game goes. And I think there were signs last week from Logan McDonald like leading up and hitting up on a wing that if he can be part of a passage that kicks a goal early in the game, then look out. I'm confident.
Anyway, you've successfully talked yourself into it. So now you feel better. Just tell me, I'm just looking at that jumper. Is that have you got Peter Bedford or Bobby Skilton's signature on the back of that?
No.
Ricky Quaid? What about Ricky Quaid?
I had one with Mark Bay's signature once.
One of the most beautiful left foot kicks to ever play the game, that guy.
Reminds me of a younger Rob Scurry.
Thanks, sir.
Beautiful leg on him. Just kicking in baggy jeans and skate shoes once upon a time. And I couldn't believe the leg on the man.
That was
easily surprises Rob Scurry. Let's just finish the AFL with a selection and a Norm Smith medalist. Gano.
Swannies to win. And our man, Pats.
Rob.
I was going to go Swannies and Pats, but you're going first, Gano.
You can jump on the bandwagon.
Local boy, Isaac Heaney, that poster boy for the AFL. I think, you know, he'll be enormous. Taking mark of the year. He's got to be favourite, you'd think, for the Norm Smith. Haven't looked at it, but he'd be my pick for favourite.
Jono.
All Blacks 13 plus.
So Jono only knows two names. They've gone.
It's All Blacks versus Wallabies at about 7 p.m. Well, it must be 5 p.m. your time. So I don't think many people will be watching that from your country, will they?
There was the same last weekend, mate. No one watched it then either.
65,000 they got.
I'll go Swans to win just because if they don't, I don't know if Jack will be around next week.
You'll have a hard week. And who do you think will be best on ground? Jono, that's what the Norm Smith medal is.
Tom Papley. Because I don't know if there's anyone else. And I don't know if anyone else.
Butch?
Swans to win, and I think with the anomaly in the ruck, I'm going to go Norm Smith, Brody Grundy.
Swans, and I think you spread your Norm Smith at the back end of it. You go like Jake Lloyd, Justin McInerney, Will Hayward.
I know him too.
Maybe even a Luke Parker. He might get off the leash playing on.
We haven't got time for the name the team, Jack, from the back line. Christ.
Righto, that's the AFL. Go Swans. Now we really changed tact. And I know this is a bloodstock and betting podcast, and we will get to it. But the man who's sort of driven this show being recorded today is Rob Scurry. And he's got a severe obsession with US politics and tin hat stuff and conspiracies. And one of the ones he's been working on for a fair while involves a famous rapper. And it's starting to sort of come to life. And he's becoming more and more vindicated in his beliefs and his theories. Take it away, Roberto. He's on mute.
It's going to be hard. It's going to be hard.
Honestly.
It's going to be hard from here.
I didn't want to be, butting in like I can do, but I've done a novelty market, like 190%. We've got 13 runners, like a Deadpool. If you haven't seen that movie, it's a good.
Probably just need to explain to people what we're talking about.
Bit of context.
Yeah, a bit of context.
Well, have you seen the movie Deadpool with Clint Eastwood? What a movie.
This is a long way to go about it.
Yeah. Butch, you've seen Deadpool. Anyway, 70s movies, if you haven't got into them, they're a lot better than the garbage on Netflix. But it's like a market where someone's going to die. And I've got, 13 runners, and I've done up a market at like 180%, in the spirit of our English corporate bookmakers. We don't want to give the punters too much of a chance, but there's 13 runners, and it's up to 2050, where he's $101 to still be alive.
Who are we talking about?
Sean Puff Daddy Coombs.
We got there.
No, it's amazing you don't know about it. This guy's, he's a billionaire. He's up on racketeering charges and sex trafficking, which are two serious charges. But the one that should have the industry worried is the bribery charges, because he's freak-off parties. You haven't heard of it? They're talking about freak-off in courtrooms, which is kind of funny. But his freak-off parties were recorded, so some people are calling him the Black Epstein. But, he recorded with Puff Daddy and Notorious B.I.G. So if you don't know anything about rap music, but entertainment world is tied up with this guy, and the freak-off parties are, I don't know why we don't know. We get saturated with this media, and yet people don't know. You hadn't heard of Sean Puff Daddy Coombs up on charges, Butch?
I can you give me a bit of context about the parties? What happens?
If
you know what he's talking about, like.
Okay, well, the case was started against him by his ex-girlfriend Cassie, who he's now deceased. sadly. But yeah, that was the first look into him, and that started an investigation where it's got to the point where he's had his house raided. He's in jail. He's been denied bail for $50 million. He put up. He said no. And they've moved, they've got 1,000 bottles of lubes and like maybe 300 dildos. And there's celebrities and Hollywood big shots all around the case.
This in his jail cell.
Butch, is that too many?
No, that's in his house.
Can you give me an over-under?
Are we back at the Seymour Swingers Convention again?
I tell you what, it puts us to shame. The 44 gallon drum of lube and the 300 dildo. I mean, Jesus.
You would think that the people in the media and would be interested in this case. It's got everything because there might be other players. That's why I don't think he's going to live, because he's got videotape on some powerful people, which, you know, in my mind, has the guards getting ready to fall asleep while
what's the market? What have we got?
All right, well, you pick. You say a date, and I'll give you a price between now and 2050.
For him to live until?
To survive 2024.
He won't make it until Christmas.
Is this going to be self-inflicted, Rob, or?
Yeah, $4.
$4?
What, for self-inflicted?
Yeah, because I've got him
dead in
2 weeks. Because I've got him dead in 2 weeks at $12.
Ooh. So was Epstein self-inflicted, or was there?
Officially,
I think it's like a trip and fall scenario.
Right, okay, yep. Yeah, a bit like how Carl Williams met his demise.
Yep.
Riding a push bike.
So, you know, we've got by sentencing, which is I've got Jan, you know, 26, I've got that like $8. So anyway, interested.
I'm impressed you framed a market.
Got it all written down on paper.
I'll take pre-Christmas.
Pre-Christmas? All right. Well, yeah.
Christmas Eve sort of set up.
Are you factoring in like the Epstein noise? Like maybe they don't want to do it again, so they just
exactly. Of course, I'm factoring that in. It's too obvious.
I'm thinking that Christmas Day, like the media will be off. Everyone's having a day off, and like Boxing Day, the sales they won't worry about it and just be brushed over. So
taking out the trash sort of stuff.
Yeah, I'll take the 25th of December, Rob, for $4.
that's Rob, good.
Rob, yeah. Where does Kamala fit into the story with P. Diddy?
I believe she does.
Oh, no.
If Twitter's got anything to go by.
Well, look, I'd say LeBron James is like the most sort of, you know, he's got some concerns because he's on camera saying there ain't no party like a Diddy party. Like, really,
if you bring up Tiger Woods, this could be the end of me.
It just depends. I haven't heard anything about X and Twitter. Like, are you on the for you algorithm or the following algorithm? If you're on the following,
it's
pretty like sort of playing the V straight bat sort of stuff.
Yeah.
And if you go for you, then Elon's just at work.
I've just picked up on the common thread here of all these people you've mentioned, Rob. They're famous Americans.
that's it. Well, popular culture, black culture, Puff Daddy is one of the giants.
Is Justin Bieber involved?
Yes, sadly.
As a victim, isn't it?
Yeah, as a victim.
Yeah.
Yes, Jono's a little bit quiet. Jono's a little bit more than what he's letting on about this kind of thing, I reckon.
Yeah.
I know.
I spent 15 hours doing the Brownlow Medal the other night. How long have you spent on this, Rob?
Oh, no. I only spent about 15 minutes, 10 minutes.
Yeah. Okay.
All right. So we'll finish up the P. Diddy case, which we'll obviously continue to follow. Rob, where are you suggesting punters go with their bet?
Yeah. Well, I've got $1.90 that he'll be knocked by his trial date, which is in I've got tipped August, so around 10 months time. So he's still he's going to be locked in jail until then. But that's between now and then $1.90. I think that's a fairly safe bet. That like Epstein, they won't want him talking in open court.
Is there any connection with Donald Trump?
Yeah, while we're on, that's a good segue. Let's roll into Donald. Is there a connection to Donald, Rob?
And, oh, for sure.
And was he actually shot?
Twice.
Good. Oh, the second one he wasn't. That was like some real, you know, Caddyshack stuff there with the bloke, and, you know, on the golf course poking his barrel of gun out of a bush. But the first one, that was the bullet, wasn't it? It's a bit weird that his ear seems fine now, but it's hard to know.
Might have been the hyperbaric chamber.
They seemed to gather great extremes. If it wasn't real, they blew someone's head off behind him just to make it look like
which isn't out of the realms of possibility.
The poor bugger behind him, head went like a watermelon. So,
Grim. Yeah, look, Donald is photoed with everyone. Everyone's photoed with, you know, the movers and shakers. You're sort of you're out.
Rob Epstein, he'll survive P. Diddy.
But you think so,
Rob? What about the Obamas, Michelle and Barack? Any?
Michael. Look, there's a bit of talk with John Legend and Chrissy Teigen talking about she was hit up on the red carpet. What's the weirdest place or funniest place you've ever got freaky? And she mentioned the Obamas, and then John Legend's face just sort of drops and he starts sweating and he doesn't want to talk about it. It's fun footage. It's just easy to find. That's Chrissy Teigen and John Legend, another singer that Diddy had under his wing. Usher being another one who's wiped his X account and Instagram account along with Pink recently. You've ever heard of Pink? She's come out to Australia.
Yeah.
Is she doing the grand final pre-match?
I think she's doing the big show tomorrow on Saturday, isn't she?
Was that Katy Perry?
Yeah, it's Katy Perry, who looks after Orlando if he does the dishes. What a woman.
Fantastic.
Toto's going to be busy.
Yeah.
All right. Who's winning the election at the moment, Rob?
I'm going to say the polls are wrong. I think Trump's not a bad bet at 220, 210. He was $4 when Hillary couldn't lose. I think America's not in a good state at the moment. And what do you the option? I think a lot of people will vote for Trump but say they voted for Kamala, you know?
All right, time will tell. Let's straighten up now and talk ponies for a little bit. Jono, a glorious result at Ipswich today. He was dead set greener than Snoop Dogg's lungs, but he got the job done. That is Mr. Tadashi. Looks like he might stay all day, and if he can get himself together mentally, he might be a hell of a lot of fun.
Yeah. Yep, mate. Congratulations to the ownership group. They've been pretty patient with him. But yeah, as you said, good to get the win, the maiden win out of the way. I don't think the field he beat was much, but he does appear to stay all day. And as we know, the staying ranks anywhere, but particularly Queensland, are pretty low. So hopefully he can keep getting through his grades up there.
He did pull for 1,200 metres of the race and still win.
He did.
Yeah.
Yep, he's got plenty to learn. Hopefully, he can learn his craft a bit better.
Hey, Robbie, have you got a story to tell us? Sorry, Jack, that's a great win. Just want to remind Robbie does have a story to tell us from Wednesday as well. I'd hate to miss it.
Okay, yeah. First race, I got to Warwick Farm, got to my usual spot, and leaning against the rail, and there's a little sort of like, let's say, the boomer generation. She's got to be 70, because a quietly spoken little lady says to me, would you mind not leaning on the rail and leaning forward? And I said, is it your first day? And she said, yeah. I said, well, I'm here every week. And then I pointed across to some other people who were also leaning on the rail. And because I felt quite victimized by this. So he really got my back up. And I said, look, you go tell them all to stop leaning on the rail, and then I'll, come back and talk to me, because I'm going to continue leaning on my rail. Because I'm just putting my elbows on the rail while I'm doing the, typing on my phone, trying to get the message out to the MYM. I was looking at what looked to be a certainty in number six, first up from a spell. But yeah, this lady really rocked me, and I couldn't bet in the race. And of course, it bloody well bolted in, so I was bit taken aback, but that's what happened to me yesterday. ATC find amazing new ways to offend me, and my yeah. So maybe we bet on football, Jack. I don't know that. What have I done? Well, what's she doing? It's unbelievable.
What a world.
Oh, well, everyone's entitled to their opinion, and you're entitled to sort of explain to her why you'll just do you and she can do her. And
did she go and take to the other 43 people that were holding on the rail, or did she just sort of
there was about 15. I think she conceded the point that she tried to step to be a Karen, let's say, and it was a bit of a backfire on her. To her credit, she sort of minds the gate. So I'll make literally the first person the horse is going to walk past for the first time, usually. So she's thinking that, you know, by me being there, I guess I could spook the horses. But, you know, I didn't tell her that I'm, you know, like a professor in equinology and horse behavioral. I could have. But yeah, anyway, I was going to ask your name and you know, make her feel even worse about it and kind of rub it in, but I'm not that bitter.
All right. Okay, cool. Jack, big day on English. Digital yesterday.
A glorious day on the digital. Very, very, very busy. We're able to take home three horses. We'll start with Legio 10 from the Godolphin camp, who's just finished a spell. A nice Saturday horse, I think. A horse that, you know, that great of horse when they're sort of benchmarked. You get like two or three runs in a prep where you can win a Saturday race, and more often than not, that horse just had a couple of things go against it, which I think helped us secure him for the price we did. I think with Gavin's polish and our placement and our tactics, we can hope to win Saturday races with Legio 10. If we win one, we're going to be all right, and if we can win two or more, it's going to be a really, really good result. But, you know, you can guarantee the horse will be racing in good races on Saturdays and if not Wednesdays in Melbourne. He heads to Gavin Bedgood. He'll begin pre-training at Caroline Price's, which is the sort of system we've used now for the last little bit. He'll kick that off probably on, I don't know, he mightn't be there right now, to be honest, but he'll be there. If not Thursday today, he'll be there tomorrow, Friday. And he's a genuinely exciting horse. He's a horse like how it works on the digital. And you know, we were all on the chat yesterday. Those sort of horses can go for 180, 250 pretty quickly. And you just got to do your work and pray to God and Zeus and Allah and Bilbo and all of them that you know, they slip through. And I was really, really happy that he was the one that slipped through yesterday, because there was a couple there around that price point that we would have bought. But he was certainly the one we wanted, and we were able to get him. Really happy. He heads to Gavin. Gavin really wanted the horse. And, yeah, I think he's going to be a really good horse for us and our owners.
Yep. Group one, Gavin. I don't know if we've had a podcast since he won his group one there with Mornington Glory and Moya. But I'm sure he'll do a great job with Legio 10. The other one, Highlands, probably the one we've said it a few times with a few of our horses, but a very easy bet to have.
Yeah, he's gonna win a maiden. I've got no doubt about it. Just with a little bit better placement and tactics, he's got form and SPs in maidens around progressive horses like Half Yours that went to town and it failed. It might have been Sandown last Wednesday, but he started extremely short in a good race. And the form out of that race, you'll stand up, and some of those horses are backing up on Saturday at Sandown again. So. I think it's a really easy bet, a great entry point for anyone that's wants to get involved, hasn't been involved, and doesn't want to spend a heap. That horse will spell for a little bit longer, then it will be brought back through Caroline Price's again, where it'll pre-train, and then Gavin will take over, and we will place him to advantage. He'll also come back in at a nice soft time of year on suitable tracks, and we'll be able to get him through his grades and then we'll reassess from there. He could end up being a trade horse that we're not in forever. Really, really confident he wins a maiden, which will pay for himself. And I think is a great entry point for anyone that's interested in getting involved for not a lot of spend, John.
Yeah, he's placed seven times from his eight career starts. So very consistent, knocking on the door. He's ran well on soft seven, good four synthetic tracks. So, and from 1100 up to 1400. So he's very versatile. And he puts himself on speed, which is a massive asset. And yeah, he'll be breaking his maiden in no time, I would have thought. And the final one, another good value purchase heading to New South Wales, Outspeed by Tavistock.
Yeah, really exciting little horse this. Cheap. Was trained briefly by Uncle Chris and then Charlotte, who's also on TV. So now we'll spell. We'll go to Caroline Price's, the same as every other horse we've bought. And then we'll find its way north to Mitch Beer, where Gano and Mitch will take over everything and place the horse to advantage. Those maidens up there are rich. And as we saw today with Mr. Tadashi, the further they get, the softer they are. So I'm quietly confident this horse has a little bit more scope than just a maiden, just because I think it's capable of getting a trip. And I think, again, a really nice entry point if you want to race one in New South Wales at really competitive training rates. Mitch Beer's done a really good job so far with the horses we've sent him, obviously heavily assisted by the guidance and the hard work that is Mickey Gannon. But he heads into a system now that we've shown works, bought with a system that we know works, and he's an exciting horse. He's not no superstar, but he's certainly a horse I'm confident wins his maiden, and we can go on from there.
Yep, half brother to Lord Ardmore, Rob, you'd be aware of. A good sort of Saturday stayer there in Sydney. You're on mute. But by Tavistock, Lord Ardmore by Reliable Man. So I'd say the better sire there.
Well, yeah, man. Like Reliable Man hasn't done much at all. Butch, you got to say, they've been a bit of a disappointment. I think Huey Bowman said it was almost his best horse he ever rode before Winks. Reliable Man, the great. Beat Racing to Win back in the day. But I, Jack, you just think this is just another easy one to bump up that runners to winners. What are we at, Jono?
60 after today, 67.44.
Is that strike rate north of 20% yet?
19.18 for wins to races.
Hopefully, we'll fix that over the weekend with some nice runners across the weekend, which we'll finish with today. Butch, thoughts on Legio 10?
Well, I think they're very transparent, the Godolphin organisation, and there's been many handy horses bought out of there. That's the you buy with confidence. They're not punished. There's always something left. So I think they're a great target horse, the second-hand Godolphin horse. Yeah, all upside and just the change of environments, you know, what you're pinning and what has worked in the past. So that's, you know.
Yeah, he's only had the 18 starts. He's a five-year-old, so plenty of racing left in him.
Yeah.
A bit like, you know, he's not as mad as Marshall Music was, but he's still a horse that could, you know, relax and perform better with the change of environment and get his head a bit better. If you get the head right, they tend to run as hard as they can, you know. Hurt themselves. The noble breed.
Well, that's the three horses we purchased yesterday on the English Digital. Shares available in each and every one of them. If you're interested to find out more, please email Jono, J-O-N-O, at themailbag.com.au. Let's have a look now, boys, at the Manicato Stakes. It's Friday night, tomorrow night, three-year-olds and up. It's a very, very good race. They've made a good call moving this race around, Mickey Gannon. Good field.
Mute.
I'm mute. There's a lot of mutes. You're on mute, should be the new name of the show. Mickey
Unbelievable.
Gannon.
Unbelievable stuff. Sorry there, fellas. Great race. Great, you know, great card too. Not just a, you know, a good Manicato Stakes, but a really good card. You've got two of the biggest stars in the Victorian racing game going head-to-head in the Fian. They wanted a match race. I believe the owners of Pride of Jenny, well, they pretty much got that. So that'll be great. But I'm really looking forward to the Manicato Stakes. Oof, I'll tell you what, a few good horses going around here. It's going to go in the camp of Growing Empire, 52 kilos, rolls forward hard to beat. Bushy boy, what do you got for us? Who's your tip in the Manicato?
Love the value. I'm going Climbing Star. I think lightly raced, very, very promising. Philip Stokes. Yeah, that appeals. I think there's a lot of exposed form. I like the you know, the what could be's, and that shoving she falls into that category.
Dicko, you've obviously done this race within an inch of its life. Do you give a horse like Coleman any chance at all? As a horse that was pretty good as a two-year-old, wasn't far away, draws one, Kieran aboard.
Oh, yeah, I give it a good chance. I think it's going to get a great run. It's going to get the best run, I think, of the three-year-olds.
Yeah.
I don't know why Growing Empire's here. I would have left it and gone straight to the Coolmore and started
because
$2.
Because they want to win a Group 1. And then go to the Everest, but they won't go to the Everest unless they want a Group 1. Riddle me that.
Yeah, so it's like sort of moving the goalposts on the run.
Correct.
Mm. I don't know. We'll probably, Butch probably got more educated opinions on that than I, but I don't like it. And I think that whilst this on paper looks like it's going to get a nice run, it's a Group 1. They're yeah. going to like hammer the horse and he's going to go the fastest he's ever gone in his life around the tightest track he's ever gone around. He's gone around this horse, this track one other time, and he was completely blessed in run the day he did it. Ethan Brown kicked up and put spy wire in a pocket. Johnny Allen got stuck in the coffin. I think it's high risk for the horse. Estrella's going to jam it. It's going to be three wide, no cover. A lot of this will come down to how the track's racing and how the speed is early. I think it's going to be intense, and I think it sets up like I Wish I Win will savage the line, and it'll just be if Growing Empire and Recommendation puncture, then that's going to jam the Colemans of the race and the Hayasugis who will be sneaking runs up the inside. If they kick, which I think one might, I think Recommendation will run a good race here. Coleman and Hayasugi will sneak up the inside, but there's not a lot of juice in their prices. I think the market's really tight, and if I had to have a bet, I'd probably have something on Johnny Rocker.
Love that. Jono, what do you got for the Manicato?
V8. D lane, probably course sort of wide with cover, hopefully. But he's 3 from 3 fresh. 1 from 1 over the track and distance. He could be the one storming home late.
I think he won it with Hay Doc, didn't he? The Manicato, first up at a price.
Righto, Rob, hit us up.
I Wish I Win for me. You know, you have to skirt wide and be an absolute freak of a thing, and that's what I think he is. So he's good. I think he'll go very close.
Yeah, I'm going to pivot. I think you make really good points, Jack, and I haven't done the race for longer than about 30 seconds. I think Coleman is probably the better of the three-year-olds that you spot on. At the price, I'll go that way. All right, anything else at the Valley? I like
Dawson. No one that you're in the coffin at best, and you might not get out. But
that's okay.
Yeah. Butch, what do you think about Growing Empire?
Well, I think when these potential stallion prospects get racing, there's some really strange decisions and panicky decisions made.
Yep.
And I don't necessarily know whether Coleman, I think a good gate sees him get a better run. I don't necessarily think he needs a set of blinkers on. So that's a strange one. And, you know, this obsession to win a Group 1 race, and I think Glowing Empire, to me, probably had the Coolmore at his mercy. And you just worry that he's now tackling this tougher race. And there's like a lot of them. You've got to be very careful. You don't run in everything and win nothing. Yeah. So that's you know.
I sort of would understand Butch accepting in the race and having a look at the race.
Yep.
But then going, like we just said at the start, fuck, this is a really strong edition of the Manicato. This race is back. All right, well, we had a look. It looks red hot. We don't need it. He's humming. We know where we're going with him. He can run the Everest next year.
Yep. Yep. There's going to be there's one of those second up horses, whether it's Johnny Rocker, Coleman, you know, that I Wish I Win. One of the second up horses is going to put in a blinder. So, you know, that you can guarantee that. But yeah, I just think it's always been a source of amusement for me because they get obsessed with winning. And yet our three best stallions never won a Group One. So I don't get the obsession with it. I think if you just placed your horse right and everyone sees him as a good racehorse and winning more than not, that to me that would be enough. I think they overthink it too much, to be honest.
Gannon, you got anything else over the night racing there, the Group One night, Grand Final Eve at the Valley?
Yeah, I'm a big fan of Dawn Service. Probably the only bet that I have on the night. I just think he's got a heaps of ability. I like what he did at Flemington. I think the Valley suits more. I don't mind the fact that Rob's brother-in-law was Tasmanian horse is going to make us work for it for old man, old mate Cody Jordan. That's fine. Blake will do the job, and I think Dawn Service is progressive, and I think he can be competitive in a pot for guineas if he draws a gate.
Nice. 1 point. I thought Asselfina in the last against Grinzinger Bell was Asselfina was enormous at the Flemington meeting, three wide, no cover, very, very brave. Agree, Dawn Service hard to beat. The best bet for me though on the card there at Moonee Valley is a Tommy to play race one. Good bet, the 8 Gallant Son, who was enormous and just destroyed the clock.
The spook is huge, that horse.
Trialed big time. The best trial ahead in the Moonee Valley on Friday night. But Stolly Bolly, not suited last start, shin on, going to get the complete PR. Will be in the 1-1, I think. I'm going to back both. That's the 6 and the 8 in race one at Moonee Valley. Boys, anything else at the Valley before we head to the Golden Rose on Saturday?
Nothing else for me.
Golden Rose, Rob, give us your rundown. How are the key runners sort of progressing along? Have you caught any trials? What are you thinking at this early stage?
I haven't watched too many trials. As you know, this is a proper Group One. I was pleased to see PG Moody this week coming out saying
P Diddy. This could be a countdown.
But saying maybe we need less if we're going to give Everest and these all these other races now Group One status, we've got to get rid of a few. But this is a race that they shouldn't. This is a real stallion making race. And if you recall last year, I was pretty keen on NCAP at a big price. This year, I'm pretty keen on Am I Right? I think this is an Uncle Chris horse by the number one sire in Australia. Get back to Bloodstock. This is a very, very valuable horse. The rain, again, and I'll be watching it very closely, really helps this guy. Nashra Willer, nice barrier. I just think he's a shortener. He's going to shorten. I'm excited about that extreme court. The top of the market, you've got Broadsiding, he's got Rain, Blessed. Storm Boy, I think he's got issues at the start, but he's going to guarantee speed in the race, so a truly run. This is probably his target. I think they sold him for $40 million, boys. If he wins this, all of a sudden he's worth $40 million. So it's huge, huge. It's game on there. Linebacker in the race somehow, for sure, but I think he will drift. That's it. But I think MRI just sets up really, really well. Bit of a prep run last start, and I think it's a very, very talented horse.
Yeah, I agree with you there, Rob. It'll start single figures, especially, you know, they've had 10 mils yesterday. They'll get probably 20 mils today at some stage. You know, the track will be soft, whether it's a 5 or 6, that's the question. And I think they'll back it. They had a big spruik on that horse, and it's good. It's a good horse. I think Storm Boy tags a node. I think that's perfect for it. I couldn't be more against Broadsiding Barrier One. You got, you know, J Mac aboard, but he'll need more than J Mac. Biggest false favorite I've seen in a while. I expect to start $4 plus first up. Give me a spell.
Have you not seen his trial versus Alicia Roma?
Yeah.
nice there, Jono. Traffic Warden. You think it'll start shorter than Broadsiding?
Yeah, it's a good question. I reckon they'll be probably the same price. The map's really awkward for Traffic Warden, and J Mac being J Mac, he'll be nice and aggressive. And Benny Mellum, I think he might get caught 3 wide and have to go back to last. Look, they've got Dominic Byrne working for them, so that. You know, if I worked it out, Dominic probably worked it out last week, that if J-Mac is too aggressive, then Tropical Warden's going to struggle to get in. So, you know, you'd imagine that they would have had that conversation, and J-Mac isn't, but he's a competitor and he might just not give two hoots. So it'll be interesting to see what happens. I think Storm Boy can win the race as long as it's no worse than a soft five. And if it's worse than a soft five, I think Emirates the horse to beat.
Butchie Boy, what are you doing?
I'm not convinced about Storm Boy. I'd need to sort of look at him again. I would say mix right with race tactics going to play a big part in this. So if they can maybe conjure up something that suits them, then I think it'll play into their hands. I don't know some of these fringe players, but when you look at the stallions in the race, you know, but they all want Group 1 winners. Too Darn Hot's not coming back, means nothing to him. Street Boss, his story's been told. It's not a game changer for him. Dustify's not coming back. It's going to mean a lot for Super Seth if Linebacker can win. I'm Invincible, won't change his life. Pierrata, it'll mean the world to him. Fast Ant Rock's done. Extreme Choice, Justify, I'm Invincible. So the big result would be for Pierrata or a Super Seth won the race. Chances of that happening, Mick Gannon?
Linebacker to chance.
Yeah. So that would be...
Needs to parade properly, Rob. Like, just like a... Just need to switch on. Yeah, needs to put it away and be focused. Although what happens, Rob, have you ever seen a case where they look focused and puts it away and they run worse? Is that a possibility? Or is that just never
happened? No, that happens. That happens. Yeah. It doesn't happen. I remember Extreme Choice used to run really well with a raging boner out.
A bit like Jack walking into the club with his swagger, or he comes in a bit flat, you know, which one I'd prefer to be around.
Yeah. They reckon back in the day, Jack used to wander into the club with the open neck trousers.
So the next cult we get, you know what we're calling it? Baz Lenker. Go and have a look at him on Instagram. Some of his best work, get in the pool.
Linebacker, they had zero intent first up, obviously, in the run to the Rose.
He did.
Which makes sense. And he was massive up the fence there. Rain wouldn't concern him too much up to the 1400 suits. I think he'll be running pretty well. But yeah, 650 is a bit short for him, I would have thought. But
sorry, John.
You're right. I just said I'm with him.
I like Tropicus at the big price each way. I think it's a really tricky race. I like Linebacker, but I think he's too short, and I respect most of the market. But I think Tropico's been hitting the line like a good horse. If he gets the right shape or gets a toe at the right time, I think he's going to savage the line. And, you know, sometimes this race it can be that sort of savager. I remember the only highlight of the darkest day, one of them of my life, the Geelong Grand Final, was watching Jacquinot let down and piss in but he came from the back and he was savaging it the whole way home and
wasn't even in the screen.
Yeah, it was a highlight on a dark day. I still remember it. And I think Tropicus sort of sets up a little bit like that.
Yeah.
And I'm just sort of going with that it's $26 versus all those other things that are single figures. I agree with Rob that Emirate does look the other option for me as a tip.
Just you want to bet early.
Price. Yep. So $14 around for Emirate and $26 around for Tropicus. That's how I'm playing the Golden Rose. Jono, what's a week ahead look like for Mailbag Bloodstock as we wrap up Just a Walk? Thanks. You're on mute.
I'm not.
Not on mute. That's just what I'm
talking about now. busy next few days. Benalla tomorrow. Cruise Missile possible. Drawn horribly again. But it's been a little while between runs, so possibly see how that field looks in the morning. Lismore, Major L, looking for 4 from 4, I think it is, at Lismore. He's got a perfect record there anyway. It's either 2 from 2 or 3 from 3, but I think it's 3 from 3. He's got the 3 kilos off his back, 54.5. Won't know himself out in front. Looks extremely hard to beat again. Danusta has gone back to New South Wales, chasing that wet weather. So hopefully as wet as it can get for him. Keats Sandown over 1800. He's got a very good figure there over the 1800 at Sandown. He's racing well, and his fitness keeps improving. He'll improve again off Saturday, but he can run well again. And Sunday, Mornington Pesto heads to the listed, I believe it's listed, RM Ansett Classic over 2,400 metres. Been screaming out for the 2,400 metres. Gets his blinkers on. And he can run okay.
Which would have done a fair bit of flying with Ansett back in the day.
Yep, I could even remember the jingle. Now, just before we go, Jack, can we just wind back to the last Monday when they had the first official two-year-old trials at on the Kenzo track?
A bit of bloodstock for anyone that's hung in there the whole time. Here we go.
And, for a bit of bloodstock and breeding.
P. Diddy wasn't there, was he?
No, P. Diddy wasn't spotted in the So very generic as far as, you know, the good sires and the good trainers and the smart owners go, but probably from a breeding aspect, there was two Ole Kirks, one Trials and one Farnan. So reflecting probably from what I can remember seeing at the sales, horses like Ole Kirk and Farnan throwing nice types, and that's reflected in the two-year-old trials last Monday. So we'll keep a watch on them as they progress. Like I say, the better stallions like I'm Invincible, which is probably expected, and the Zoo Stars and that. But, so from the first seasons, Ole Kirk and Farnan off to a flyer.
Do you think that will be reflected? Where will that be reflected, and how relevant is that to the market?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, absolutely. I mean, Breeders' Plate will be run on one, Colts and Fillies, and then they'll roll into some other two-year-old races here, there and everywhere. But, definitely giving the punters confidence getting to the new sales in the start of the year with those stallions. You know, that'll be reflected in the market 100%.
Beautiful. All right, that's been Just a Walk. Thanks, episode. We're not sure. I hope you enjoyed it.
14
with the P. Diddy gear, but sometimes we've just got to let Rob do what Rob needs to do. So we hope you have an absolutely phenomenal weekend. We've got runners all across the weekend, so let's pray to God, Zeus, Allah, and Bilbo that some of them and a couple of them can get across the line first and get us a win. But most importantly, go Swans, and bye for now.